Basic CRUD operations using entity framework core. So idea is simple. I want to build a ASP.NET core application and perform database operations, create, retrieve, update, delete. Obviously, this is going to be more of .NET than actually Azure. But eventually what I would like to demonstrate is the web application I'm going to publish as an app service, and the database is supposed to be using the Azure SQL Database service. So a complete end-to-end project which can be used for performing regular CRUD operations. That's what you're going to see here. Yes, this is going to be more of development and lot of .NET. But if you are a Java developer, if you are a Python developer, Node.js developer, in those languages also we have support for working with databases. The steps are almost going to be same, at least in context of Azure, nothing is going to change. So I first begin with creating a new project. Let's say this is ASP.NET Core project. ASP.NET Core web application. Say DSS DB demo app. We can say take a simple modal view controller project. Now the first thing I'm going to do is, in this project, I'm going to add two classes which I want to represent as tables, department and employee, two classes I want. So under modals only, we can add the two classes, department and employee. Replace this with the code from my handout. Now, this is supposed to have a reference to data annotations. Okay. Basically, department is going to become a table, and in that table, ID is going to be the primary key. Now, if it is column name only ID, or if it is column name department underscore ID, we don't need to do this key. But if any other name was given here, you have to mention this key so that in the table ID would become a primary key. Like that, here you see, we are saying ID is a primary key and I want FK department ID as the foreign key. Basically, I want to use entity framework code first approach. We can also give table attribute and give a name for the table. So say employees, I would like to call it as the table name. Otherwise, by default, it will be employee. And here I would like to call it as department table name. Departments, employees, two tables will be created. Now, with these two classes properly taken care of, we can let ASP.NET Core do most of the job for us. So first, build the project and ensure that there are no errors. Build started. Second, I want to make sure that I'm using the latest version. Though latest version already 6 has come, I have not installed it, 5 is good enough. Now on controllers we can right click, add a controller. We want a MVC controller with views using entity framework. This is my requirement, with actions and razor views to create, read, update, delete and list entities. So scaffolding is going to happen now. Studio scaffolding is going to automatically generate for us. Let's say I want to work with employee class. Choose a data context. My project doesn't have a data context. So I will create a new data context for the project. I'll leave the default name as it is. So there will be one class generated. There will be employees controller generated. The context class, the employees controller, lot of things are going to happen now. One by one, we will see all the things which the scaffolding template has generated. Sometimes guys, you are going to get an error at this particular step. Generally that happens because we will not be able to add the proper NuGet packages. So you should expand dependencies, check which NuGet packages are not appropriate, delete them, restart Studio and try once again if you are getting error on this particular step. And that's it. It's working now. So even if you get error, just retry. Even if it after retrying it's not working, close Studio, restart, it should work. That's pretty common problem with Studio. So you'll see now there are certain packages which are added. So we have got entity framework core, because this is a .NET core based solution. .NET 5 is completely based on .NET core. So entity framework core, SQLite, SQL server databases. And then these are all automatically added. These packages are automatically added by the scaffolding template. You'll see there is a data context class, DB context, and this has by default generated a DB set by name employee. I want to change that to employees. Plural for DB set is always recommended. But if you change here, ensure that you also do scaffolding, renaming it throughout. Just by clicking here, all the references will be renamed from employee to employees. Problem solved. Then we have got the controller. Okay, some more things will be there in startup.cs. You have got this line added in startup.cs. Basically a service to work with database to get a reference to DB context. So after this particular line, we will be able to inject the context into the controller. But the context is supposed to use SQL Server and the connection string is coming from appsettings.json. So the connection string is coming from here. So right now it is referring to the local DB on my machine. I'll just leave this as it is, but obviously this I would like to replace it with the database in cloud, Azure cloud. Now, if I simply run this project right now, it is going to execute the home controller, which is doing nothing. But in home controller, I would like to provide a link to employees controller. Employees controller index action method, which is doing context.employees.include, getting the data from the department also. And returning all the employees. So here you see details of one particular employee. We are getting first employee with the matching ID. If we get an employee, good. If not, not found error. If we get an employee, that is passed to the view. That means here views are also created. Create, delete, details, edit, index, all views are created. So all the required code, I don't want to get into the details of the code, But yes, all the code required for performing CRUD operations is pretty well generated by the scaffolding template. So only thing I would like to do is in my shared underscore layout, let's say this I would like to get rid of, and I'll call it as controller name employees and index action method to get the list of all employees. So now run this project, no changes except for linking it to the menu. I'm not doing any changes after the scaffolding has generated some code. Now click on employees. We should get an error because employees table is not there. Employees database is not there. It's trying to connect to that. And the error. SQL exception. A network related instance, SQL server is configured to allow blah, 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 blah. That the instance name is correct and the SQL server is configured to allow. The server is not found or is not accessible. Now the problem is on my machine, on my local machine, I don't have local database runtime. So what I'm going to do now is, because I don't have the local database installed on my machine, this is not going to work. So let me create a database in Azure. So I'll go to SQL database. SQL database is a ready-made service in Azure. So create an SQL database. Create a resource group. Give a database name. Employee demo DB. Some name. Server. Along with database, we have to also create a server. Right now, we don't have a server. Let's create a server. Server name, username, password. Admin is not allowed. Some password, which we are going to use for connection string. These details I'm going to use for connecting to database through the connection string. Now, when you're practicing, never keep it as Gen 5 2 V core 32 GB storage. That's very expensive. So, change from general purpose to basic. This is good enough for practice purpose. If it is costing you around 16,600 rupees, INR this will cost you around 350 rupees only. Around 360 rupees. Which is good enough for practice purpose. So always keep in mind, especially when you are working with free account, you change it. Configure, change it to basic and apply. Backup storage redundancy. We keep it as default. If you want it to be cheaper, go to LRS. Networking. This is important. Who can access this SQL database? By default, we will not have any access to this SQL database. You can provide access by selecting here public endpoint and then explicitly mentioning that from your IP address you can connect, your local IP address. So click on yes. Automatically, my local IP address will be added to the firewall. Now, if we are not doing it now, we can as well do this later. So right now, I'll keep it as no access And later when we get an error, I'll show you the error first and then I'll show you how we can connect. This is very important. Right now my SQL database is not accessible from anywhere. We don't want Defender, that's a paid service, which is more important for the production servers. Tags not required and we are okay. This will take 2 to 3 minutes. First it has to create SQL database, first it has to create SQL server, then it has to create SQL database. Now in the meantime, whatever is the connection string which we have here, that we are supposed to give it now in our code. So let's do that. So what is the connection string we give? Later I'll show you, we can pick up the connection string also. But this connection string I'm changing now in my app settings. Local DB will be changed. That is DSS demo DB server dot database dot windows dot net. That's the proper server name. And the database name we gave, employee demo DB, and we don't want trusted connection. Instead, I would like to have username password. So user ID and the password. That's the password I gave for connecting to database. Even if you know this complete connection string, including my username and password, at this point of time, you cannot connect to the database because the firewall does not allow you to. But yes, what we will do is first we'll try to connect to SQL database using a SQL Server Management Studio. So open SSMS on your machine. So give your DSS demo DB server, DSS admin and the password. And it will not allow me to connect because right now no access is there. It will give me error if, of course, the database is already, okay, database is not even created till now. We'll have to wait. See, your client IP address does not have access. The database got created and it says my address. This is my IP address actually. Because this IP address does not have access, I'm not able to connect. So what to do? Go here. Go to set server firewall. And here, client IP address, add it. So this IP address is added. This is my IP address. In Google, if you type my IP address, it will show you. It's showing 6 bytes. But yeah, that is the 4-byte IP address I have. Just say save. After saving here, try connect again. And this time it will accept my connection. So from my local machine, I am now allowed to connect to this SQL server. So from this IP address to this IP address, right now same is there. But if I give you a 0.0.0.0 to 255.255.255.255, anybody would be able to connect to that SQL database. Now in addition to this, okay, let us keep this as it is now. So I've given the proper connection string. Now, if you don't have the connection string, you can also go back to database and click on connection strings and get the connection string from here. Same connection string it is. You have to just replace the password with the right value. Put the password and you're done. So now let us run this. Now at least it will get the database. I mean, it will find the server, but it will still not find the database and the table. Database is also there actually, but the table is not there. Invalid object name employees. From my machine also, this is localhost. It is able to connect to the database, but not finding the table employees. What shall we do? Yes, we have to now generate a migration script. And that migration script is responsible for creating the table. So how to generate a migration script? Go to Package Manager console and type here add migration. That's it. Some name you have to give. Initial schema. So it is going to rebuild the complete project and a migration script is generated. You see, migrations folder is generated. And once you have the migration folder, through this migration script, which is responsible for building the complete model. Basically, you see here, there will be up method, down method, and these methods will be responsible for creating all the build model, all the table properties. So in initial schema, up method is there. Up method creates the table. Down method drops the table. So these scripts are going to execute. But right now, if you simply run this, you will still get the error. Migration code is there, but the migration code is not executed yet. We want the migration code to execute. Only when migration code executes, it is going to create this table. So how do we execute the migration code? And that is supposed to be one time job. So ideal place to write that code would be program.cs. Now this line I'm commenting. To execute the migration code, we need the reference to the DB context. And the DB context, see, all this is generated, auto-generated. DB context is auto-generated. And the DB context we can get from a service. So from host, we are going to get all the services. And here we are going to get the required service. So all this code I'll copy and I'll paste it in my run. Create web host builder. It's supposed to be create host builder. That name has changed. Okay. And this is supposed to be the DB context class name. We have it here. And you have to add the namespace. Some namespace here also. Dependency injection. So this one, database context dot database dot migrate. That's what is needed actually. Using Microsoft dot entity framework core. So this is the line actually, which is going to execute the migration code. And that execution of the migration code will create table and columns. Now let us see what will happen. I am still running the application locally. That means I am still teaching you the part which is supposed to be developer specific. no records are there. Now create a new record. Department not filling up. So how to fill the department? Now to fill the department, first I need to have records in the department table. So now go to SSMS. SQL Server Management Studio. Expand database. Check up, we should have here department table, employee table. Now you might use scaffolding and generate table department also CRUD operations. You can just do that. Or else manually insert the records here. That's your choice. I am taking a shortcut, manually inserting it. Otherwise, I can add a department's controller also. ID, just say DA, true, the record gets inserted. Some DB, true, we are not doing any filtration or anything, all the departments will be shown. Just reconfirm that they got inserted in the department table. Third record is false, but still, because we are not doing filtering, even that should come. Let's again go to the browser, refresh this, and you see we got this. Of course, IDs are coming. You know, you can change code and instead of ID, get the names there. Anyways, employee and some salary. Here also, instead of displaying ID, you may want to display name. You can do all that. So, something. Right now, we have successfully executed the application on the local machine. Now it's time to turn to Azure and deploy this application in Azure and see what changes we will have to make there. So from here itself, I'll create even the app service. Right click, publish. Target is Azure. Click on next. Azure App Service. Connect to the right subscription. We already have one app service. We can either use this itself or from here we can create a new app service. I'm creating a new app service. And this app service will require to connect to the SQL database. It will take a minute for this app service to get created. It's done. So we have a new resource group, new app service. If you want, you can definitely go for slots also. I don't have slots, so I'm for now okay. Click on finish. A profile will be created. Publish profile is created. And you see here connection string. It is automatically connecting to SQL database. Basically, some service dependency we are able to create on this service. We would like to make it dependent. So Azure App Settings, save the connection string value in Azure App Service. All studio benefit, if you're not doing this through studio, you'll have to do this manually. Configure. Now publish. So the complete project is going to be published to the app service. And in app service, we will see app settings, connection string will be there. So basically whatever we have here, right now you see for development purpose, I directly used Azure, but that's not the real case. For development purpose, you should always use local database. Because I don't have local database running on my machine, I had no choice but to directly make use of Azure. So here in local connection string, in appsettings.json, local DB should be there. You test locally, you do everything locally. And later, after the publish is done, you go to the portal, and in portal, you should go to the app service. And under app service, we should have configuration. Here we will set the connection string. You see, automatically it has come. DSS DB demo app context. With the proper connection string, it has automatically come. Why it has come? Because in studio, I made it dependent. The dependency service it is. So in case you're working with local database differently and Azure database should be used by Azure App Service, this is the best option to do. Now remember, because this is connection string section and this is connection string section, this name is directly used there. Whatever is the name here, the same name is used here. So if you have not used the connected service feature, you have to come here, manually add this particular connection string. Change here to SQL Azure. All good. We don't have to make any changes. Now this is my web app. Go to employees. Is it connecting? No, it is still not connecting. Why? The database doesn't allow app service to connect. Now for database to allow app service to connect, you should again go to firewall. Change here, allow Azure services and resources to access this server. Click on yes. Azure App Service is an Azure service. And only when you put a check mark here, Azure App Service will be connecting. It will take a minute max. Close all this. Refresh. And we should get the data. Fantastic. Whatever data we have got from local machine, the same thing we are able to get here also. Fantastic. You can even edit. So this is how we are able to develop an application locally and we are able to deploy into Azure. And at the time of deployment, only two things you have to take care of. One is Azure App Service should be allowed. Second is in App Service, we should have under configuration, the connection string properly set to the database, which is nothing but overwriting this value. Now, good thing about this whole exercise is, if suppose, imagine now a new column gets added to my model, for some reason a new column gets added. Let's say age gets added. I want to add age. It should be get and set mandatory. Simple field member will not work. It should be a property. Now, how do I ensure that age is going to be taken care of? Somehow I have to ensure age is also taken care of in the table. Right now, the table does not have age. Age is not there. So how do I ensure age comes up there? First, go to Package Manager console. What we used earlier, add migration. Now do add migration age column. So here you will see now we have one more file added, age column. Initial schema will get created because of this. Age column is going to be added because of this. Obviously, age column to reflect, I need to have the age column facilitated in my controller. Either you edit all this code if you are comfortable with, or you can simply regenerate it. I'll delete, because anyhow we did not modify any, even a single line of code. You can delete employee controller and add it once again. So automatically Studio will take care of that age column views also. The views have to be updated. Everywhere age has to be displayed. I would also make change such that the drop-down is supposed to show me department. So right now you see context.set select list. The parameters are items, data value field and data text field. This data text field, I want to be a department name. In my department table, I have department name. That's what I want data text field to be. So replace ID and put department name. That's it. Maybe every other place also. In edit also we'll have, we want this department name. Wherever we have this, there we have to take care of. I believe that's it. Here also. Now that we have made changes, obviously we are supposed to publish. But if you don't want to have any downtime, what is the best thing to do? Create a slot. Go to your app service. For the app service, we'll create a slot. Deployment slot. We'll call it as staging. I'm cloning the app settings. So into this slot, if I publish, I want it to warm up in this particular slot and then automatically swap with the production slot instead of I doing it manually. I will publish to the deployment slot. Warm up should happen in deployment slot, the staging slot, and then it should automatically swap into production. So go to staging, go to configuration and enable auto swap there under general settings. Auto swap enabled. Swap into production. The staging will be automatically swapped into production. The advantage is we will not have any downtime. That is the advantage. And now this migrate function which is there in my program.cs, this migrate, this will ensure that the updated migration script is going to execute. But how does it know that the schema has upgraded? If you look at the tables, here there is one migration history. This migration history is actually maintaining the last migration script which got executed. So if the project finds any extra migrations, automatically those will execute. Right now only initial schema will be there in this under migration history. So now I publish, but where should I publish? I don't want to publish to that direct production slot. So delete this and create a new one. DSS demo DB app staging. Of course, again connect to database preferably. Give the username and password. Actually, no need to do this. But we are okay. So now you will see this is the best way of publishing in real time. It will publish to staging, and after publishing to staging, it will automatically swap into production. Azure will take care of that swapping. And whenever it completes swapping, we will see age column getting added here. Because through scaffolding we have regenerated. There will be zero downtime. No downtime will be there for the production. Just that on swapping complete, we will have age. This is staging right now. It's publishing to staging. Studio has opened this URL automatically. So if you look at employees, Studio is having downtime for staging. I mean, the staging has downtime, but this will not have downtime. This will come up because publishing is still happening in this. So during publish time, this is down, which is okay, because anyhow, this is staging. My production is still working. That is important to me. Wow, production came down. This is supposed to not happen. Production has come down. See, the problem is we did not do testing in staging and we swapped it into production. So actually speaking, the version which I published has problem. The version which I published went into staging, without doing testing in staging because of auto swap, it automatically got moved into production. And in production, it is failing now. Definitely there is something wrong which we have done in our code. And you see in staging, it has come to old version. The old version is staging, that is working. So first, let us restore and see what is the problem. Just swap it back again. First, swap it back. We'll see what is the problem. So at least we'll bring up the production. The code which is published first into staging and then swapped into production has problem. So I'm swapping it back. I'm bringing up production once again. Then I'll debug what is the problem in staging, solve that, and then I'll do a swap, which is the right way of doing it. Performing swap between staging and production. What was old production, we are restoring it. What was old production, we restored it. Now this is failing. Why is staging failing? Oh, because of the auto swap, it is again doing swap. Troublesome this is. So I'll do one thing. I will disable auto swap. I should have ideally tested locally and then published it. So let's do the testing on our local machine first. We did not get age. Did the age get created in database? Age has not come here also. The migrate is not happening. Let's debug. We'll put a breakpoint and see what is wrong. Migrate is executing. Migrate executed successfully, we should find age added. Not coming up. I'm pretty sure I did a mistake. I added to department rather than adding to employee. I added to the department. That's the mistake I have done. So So in department table, age will be there now. We wanted in employee table. That's the mistake I have done. So you can actually cut, add, build the project. Go to package manager console, add column 2, employee. So now you'll notice one more file is added. And in this file, if you look at up method, it is deleting it from department and adding it to the employee. Because in the new schema, in department, age is not there. So that's a mistake I did, and that's why the errors. So I delete employees once again. Right click, add controller, employees controller. I'll test it locally first. That's always a good idea. Once we know that it's working locally, then we can publish it to the remote. We are very sure that everything is working. Testing locally. Age has come. Default value, obviously 0 will be there. We are okay with it. Because we regenerated, ID gone. So that also we can take care of once again. Department name in place of ID. And likewise, I can go to context and add here departments, referring to department table, and after this go to the view index.cshtml. Right now it is showing department ID there. You can change to department name. Actually, that context is also not needed. We direct have item.department.department name because of the foreign key. Well taken care of. Same thing in other views also you may want to do. Wherever we have department ID, that we would like to replace with department name. So that's it. Done. Close all this, test it again once locally. Make sure that you're convinced everything is fine. Close all. I see a lot of people don't close studio tabs only. Your studio will get slow. When you know you're not going to work with certain tabs, close it. See, first department names have started coming. Edit. Names started coming. I changed to DB now. It's already DB. So edit. You have DB selected. Change to DC. If Fantastically, everything is working. So now publish. Already we have disabled auto swap. So we can publish and test it in staging and then do a manual swap. Automatically browser will open with the staging URL. Staging URL. Make sure that here also everything is working. Fantastic. Now do a swap into production. And we are done. Right now we are using same database for production and staging. You may have two different databases. And you can make the app settings slot specific. In staging, we can have staging database. In production, we can have production database. And that should not swap. So make it slot specific. And you may probably also do a preview of staging code with production and then swap it. You can as well do that. By using preview option. So now that this is happening, you will see there is definitely no downtime for the production. Last time the downtime was not there. The problem is the code which got published itself was not good. Now in the production we got H. So what was in production will now go into staging. What is in staging will be in production. And if you still see any problem, reswap it. And this is how, guys, precisely we do in real time. Let it be any project. Let it be any project. This is the right procedure of uploading it. We first upload to the staging. Actually, we can enable auto swap. The problem was with code. That's why it could not republish the proper version. But otherwise, yes, you can publish to staging, view everything in staging. You are convinced. Do a manual swap into production. And with no downtime, our site is going to be up and running. So this is how you can build a .NET Core application performing CRUD operations and deploy into Azure along with SQL database. That's all in this session. Thank you.